Good morning. So I'm Jacoby Wilson. I am an assistant professor at the University of Maryland College Park. So what I'll do is, and a timekeeper, definitely keep me on time. Thank you. Just going to kind of lay out what I do as it relates to citizen science and kind of maybe come at it a different route, maybe more of the earlier presentation about environmental health. So I'm an environmental health scientist, and so a lot of the work that I do is in partnership with community groups. So we use what we call the community-based participatory research framework. But for me, you know, CBPR and also citizen science, they're not really that new. And so I see citizen science as a paradigm that really is something that that we should do more of. And as an academic, I think it can be supplemental to some of the work that I do, but also it should be able to replace a lot of what we do. And in a lot of the communities that I work with, they're impacted by, they're differentially exposed to hazards. So this whole issue of environmental justice. And so a lot of the work that we do is not just about knowledge production, because as the previous speaker just mentioned, there's been a lot of exploitation of communities. And so we talk about a lot of communities that I work with, they've been impacted by what we call scientific racism. So you go into a community, you do the helicopter research, it's very extractive, you work in a community of color, and nothing comes back to really actually solve the problem. You also have research that's been done, and this is why, again, citizen science is important, we have scientific colonialism. So you're going into a community and you're there all the time, right? So your students are learning, you're getting grant dollars, you're getting publications, you're getting tenure promotion, and still nothing is done to really address the problem. Then you have scientific imperialism. So that gets to the issue of who dominates the scientific agenda, who makes the, this could be the government agencies, these could be the major universities, who gets represented in the news about as being the, the leaders in the field. And again, that really defeats the purpose of what science, in my opinion, should be. So a lot of the science that I do, science has value. We bring our own values to the science. So in the work that I do, we follow what we call Bowyer's five dimensions of science. So it's the science of inquiry, you know, data production, which is the one in academia that's one that's most commodified, the one we emphasize the most. There's the science of teaching, you know, learning from each other. You know, there's a science of interdisciplinary science, so you want to be able to address the issue from multiple dimensions. It has to be prismatic, right? So citizen science is important for that. There's a science of engagement, and there's a science of application. So getting back to the issue of so what, for us, it has to be translated to action. If you're just doing science where it's just knowledge production, for the communities that I work in where they're being impacted by a landfill, where they're being impacted by a coal fire plant, that's the issue of cumulative burden. So it's not just one source of pollution. There's multiple facilities that are releasing multiple chemicals through multiple routes and pathways of exposure. There's also other stressors, non-chemical stressors, including psychosocial stressors. So you can be in a community doing this research, and we find out that poverty impacts health, that your exposure to these chemicals impacting your health. They know that already. So what are you doing as it relates to using the data to actually translate the real action, whether it be policy change, whether it be some kind of, 5 minutes already? Wow. Some other kind of, okay, cool, thank you. Some other kind of intervention. And so for me, you know, citizen science, if you think about, I don't have any slides, but we have this community engagement paradigm. So if you can visualize the paradigm, the left side of the paradigm, you start out with outreach, you move to involvement, you move to consultation, then you move to participatory and community-driven, right? So within that paradigm, you can have citizen science where, in some cases, some of the work that I do, we're doing more outreach. We may be doing involvement and having community members help collect data. I have a mosquito project in Baltimore. We're looking at green space, urban form, and mosquito habitats. That is really more in an involvement, right? We have another project where we're looking at stormwater management issues in D.C., and we're training community members to use best management practices to reduce stormwater inputs into Chesapeake Bay. And so it has more involvement consultation, but also it's more participatory. But most of my work sits in more of the participatory community-driven end of this paradigm. And so one of the community groups that I work with long-term is the Western Revitalization Association. They're a community-based environmental justice organization in Medmen, North Carolina. They were going to be impacted by a highway without any input. They have what we call the lack of basic amenities, limited access to public regulated sewer and water infrastructure. So they're in the city limits, but they're still on well water, the roads are not paved, and they still have septic tanks. And so part of our work with that group, They came with their own framework called community-owned and managed research, in part in response to some of the researchers from my university, UNC, who were then very, they were exploiting them, they've been very extractive. So they fired all the academic researchers and they brought in students. And I was a student at the time when I started working with WERA to really help them build their research structures to collect data and use that data for action. And so part of what we did, we trained community members to collect their own water samples to look at the levels of microbes, fecal coliforms, E. coli, enterococci, and also coliphages to see if the water was contaminated from due to their septic waste, and also the took samples of local from local rivers and streams to understand whether or not their waste was impacting water quality. And so they were able to leverage that data to block the highway. They were also able to use some of that data to get first-time installation of sewer and water infrastructure and use that data to get their roads paved. Now, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done, but that's translating research to action, right? And so that's very, so to me, that is sort of the foundation of the work that I do in my career. Since that experience as a student, I've used that sort of Comer principles, equity in funding, parity in management, make sure the data is used for compliance, the data is used for action. Out of that paradigm came what we call legal epidemiology, or legal-based epidemiology, where you have the exposure disease paradigm. Instead of just focusing on the, you know, this whole black box of all these chemical exposures and stresses and figuring out what the disease, stressor A lead to disease B, we focus more on the left side of the paradigm and say, what are the sources? Are they in compliance with building codes? And really trying to figure out what are the sources of exposure, and then what laws they're not in compliance with, leveraging Title VI, and using that in a way to, again, address the problem, to get a compliance and to get action, and not being stuck on the whole epi trap. We don't allow the epi trap to stop us from getting action. So that's a paradigm that came out of the work, excuse me, with WERA. Another group that I work with long-term is the Lowcountry Alliance for Model Communities. It's a community group based in North Charleston, South Carolina. They are basically economically stressed, underserved African-American neighborhoods who are gonna be impacted by the Port of Charleston. It's the port, you know, all because of goods movement across the country, all the ports are expanding, right? So this is a goods movement community. And so they have some of the traditional EJ issues, coal fire plants, Superfund sites, an old incinerator, thank you, an old incinerator and other facilities that have psychosocial stresses, poverty, and some other issues. And so what we were able to do was to, part of the citizen science, they came to us to help them really wanted to figure out what were some of the baseline contamination issues in the community before the port expanded, so they can use that as part of the mitigation plan agreement with the Port Authority. And so we helped to train community members to collect their own air pollution data, PM2.5 and PM10, collect soil contamination data near Superfund sites and also near incinerator. And so that data is being used as part of their local environmental decision making. It's helped them with zoning and planning sort of discussions with the city. It's helped them really implement the mitigation plan agreement in a way that's more community driven. And also what came out of that, sort of the next steps, what came out of that, the collaboration, a new community group was established called CCRAB. It's the Charleston Community Research to Action Board, because they really wanted to have a community IRB. And so that CCRAB group, I'm gonna squeeze a little bit more time out of it. That CCRAB group is a group that's really driving the research now and really driving, making sure the research that we do in the future is, again, it's about action. There's a sister group that was established called Women Against Environmental Injustice, WAGE. So that's another group that came out like a product of this collaboration. And then we do a lot of public participatory GIS, PPGIS. And so we have a website called EJ Radar. It's still sort of in beta mode, but we have all the data online. So we've been training community members to map their data, and we're actually gonna have a training session in February. The community group got some grant money from a local foundation. So we can come back down to Charleston, train them to map their data. And again, they can use those maps to help with local decision making. So I could go on and on. I have other partnerships too, but thank you.
Thanks. If I could have the panelists come to the front.